Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. May I request you to kindly stand to your feet for the arrival of the presidential party? Please rise. As you know, this is the annual Dr. Ray Vijayawardena Memorial Lecture organized by the Institution of Engineers of Sri Lanka in collaboration with the Ray Vijayawardena Charitable Trust. And this evening, the presidential party is being led by the president of the Institution of Engineers of Sri Lanka, Engineer Professor T.M. Pallavatta, and he will commence this evening's proceedings with the traditional lighting of the oil lamp. May I invite the President of the Institution of Engineers of Sri Lanka to kindly do the honours. He will be followed by two past presidents of the institution, namely Engineer Professor K.K.Y. W. Pereira and Engineer Professor Sam Karunaratna. May I also call upon Engineer U.D. Jayawardena to join these distinguished guests in lighting one wick of this beautiful lamp that you see before you. As I mentioned earlier, this event is an annual event which is organized by the Institution of Engineers in collaboration with the Ray Vijayawardena Charitable Trust. And representing the trust is Professor Malik Ranasinghe, the chairman of the trust, and he too will be joining the others in dispelling a little bit of darkness in this room with the lighting of a wick. May I also call upon the chairman, Agricultural and Plantation ESC, Engineer H.C.J. Tilakaratna. I'm also honored to invite the Chief Executive Officer and Executive Secretary of the Institution of Engineers, Engineer Neil Abesekara, to kindly join the others. And representing the Ray Vijayawardena family this evening, ladies and gentlemen, is Francesca Madanayaka, and she too will be joining this august gathering with the lighting of the oil lamp. Thank you, kind sirs and ma'am. You may take your seats. You may all take your seats, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. The Ray Vijayawardena Charitable Trust and the Institution of Engineers of Sri Lanka have taken upon themselves this yeoman task of honoring an engineer who has done a great amount of service to this country. And in honoring him, as you can see, there is a beautiful portrait of this distinguished Sri Lankan, and this beautiful portrait will be garlanded this evening by the President of the Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka, Engineer Professor T.M. Pallavatta. Sir, if you could kindly do us the honor of garlanding this portrait of the man whose life and legacy we are celebrating this evening. Thank you, you may be seated. May I now call upon the President of the Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka, Professor T.M. Pallavatta, to kindly deliver the welcome address.
Hi everyone, Super Sandhyavak, a very good evening to you. It is my duty as the President of the Institution of Engineers today to welcome all of you who are here, including our guest speaker, our distinguished past presidents, council members, members of the Ray Vijayavardhana Charitable Trust, and ladies and gentlemen, not to forget our fellow engineers. From the gathering here, I can see how important and how memorable a person, engineer Dr. Ray Vijayavardhana, is. And his achievements are an inspiration to us. So, without much ado, for introducing the guest speaker, I would like to cordially invite Engineer Professor Malik Ranasinghe to the podium. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. President IESL, past presidents of the Institute of Engineers, Mr. Yudi Jayavardhana, members of the family of Dr. Ray Vijayavardhana, trustees, distinguished invitees, fellow members of the institution, ladies and gentlemen. My task this evening is to introduce our invited speaker, Mr. Yudi Jayavardhana, Director CEO of LTL Holdings, the largest and most established engineering company in Sri Lanka, for the 9th annual Dr. Ray Vijayavardhana Memorial Lecture. I consider it as a privilege and do so with great pleasure. Mr. Yudi Jayavardhana has been on the short list of the Ray Vijayavardhana Charitable Trust must invite speakers for a number of years. He, I believe, is our first speaker who had worked closely with Dr. Ray Vijayavardhana as a professional. Mr. Jayavardhana, as we all know, is an electrical engineer who graduated from the first batch of engineers from the University of Moreton. He is a chartered electrical engineer, fellow of the Institute of Engineers of Sri Lanka and the Institute of Engineering Technology, UK. Mr. Jayavardhana has been the general manager, chief executive officer and director of LTL Holdings for over 30 years. It is under his innovative leadership that LTL Holdings and its subsidiaries have entered many areas of engineering, like obviously producing transformers that meet the highest international quality standards, becoming the largest independent power producer in Sri Lanka and possibly in Bangladesh. Today, the LTL group has reached the pinnacle in Sri Lankan engineering sphere and is gaining global recognition for its engineering endeavors. As a former Vice Chancellor of University of Moratuwa, which trains most of the electrical engineers to whom Mr. Jayavardhana and LTL Holdings provides the rare opportunity to work in a very successful government organization that uses cutting-edge private sector practices, we are extremely grateful for his vision and his exceptional entrepreneurial drive. The late Dr. Ray Vijayavardhana, who was the second chancellor at the University of Moratuwa, took great pride in achievements of Mr. Yudi Jayavardhana, a fellow Thomian, engineer and entrepreneur on the global stage. The Ray Vijayavardhana Charitable Trust, which is hosting Mr. Yudi Jayavardhana as its part of the jointly organized Dr. Ray Vijayavardhana Memorial Lecture, is a trust set up to promote and sustain the vision and ideas of the legend that is Ray Vijayavardhana. The trust aims to recognize and support innovations in general and focus on sustainable agriculture, renewable energy, engineering and aeronautics, disciplines and pursuits that were close to Dr. Vijayavardhana's heart for over half a century. I can assure you the company's story on transforming local engineers into global entrepreneurs, the LTL experience, will certainly capture the spirit Dr. Ray Vijayavardhana is known and remembered for. I take great pleasure in inviting Mr. Yudi Jayavardhana to deliver the 9th annual Dr. Ray Vijayavardhana Memorial Lecture 2019 to this distinguished audience. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Professor T. M. Pallavatta, President ISL, members of the Ray Vijayawardena Charitable Trust, members of the family of Ray Vijayawardena, ladies and gentlemen, I thank the Ray Vijayawardena Charitable Trust for giving me this honor. Thank you, Malik, for extremely generous introduction about me. When Malik invited me, I accepted with alacrity since Ray was my mentor. I was closely associated with Vidyadhwati Dr. Ray Vijayawardena for over 35 years. I met him somewhat accidentally. In 1974, he came to demonstrate his two-wheel tractor and a lecture. As usual, I couldn't attend his lecture or the demonstration. In the evening, when he was collecting his things to take home, I happened to meet him and I helped him to load things to his vehicle and things like that. Then we had an initial chat. After the initial chat, we found that we had one thing in common. We were from the same school by the sea. So he invited me to for dinner. Of course, as an undergraduate, I readily accepted. So he took me home to Tarak Road. So for the first time in my life, I tasted single malt Scotch whiskey. Then after that, he gave me dinner and we had a long chat. After that, we decided to call each other by first names. I used to call him Ray, he used to call me Yudi. Thereafter, I left the country. I think he returned in 1980. When he returned, we met very regularly. When I shifted my office to Park Street, once a week we used to meet him. Always the meetings have been in this library, his library. His library is a nice place because it's a pub and his laboratory, and he had a nice butler. That when we visit regularly, his butler knows what I drink, so he brings the same drink. Later on, he used to visit my office also because it was close by. Ray had a vision. He wanted to demonstrate a dendro power plant and an engine run with gas generated from Guinea. Later on, Guinea was his famous timber boom. I can remember sometime, I don't know whether his family liked it, his lawn was full of Guinea trees. He got rid of the grass and planted Guinea. Professor Rohan Lucas and Ray was keen followers of LTL progress. I think they knew more than me about LDL progress. Ray visited all our project sites. The last one to visit was, I think, Kerala site. He visited twice. He came in 2007, if I remember right. Then I said, sir, now we are very active in Uganda and Tanzania. You are very keen to go to Uganda and Tanzania. But at that time, his health was failing. So I never encouraged him to go to Uganda and Tanzania. In the year 2000, I delivered the Vimala Suryendra lecture. Therein, I pointed out that Mahali waters priority should be given to hydroelectricity rather than the farmers, Mahali farmers. Because the farmers, they waste water, they use all the subsidies available in the world, and the water usage alone, they use 6,000 liters per kilogram of rice. Whereas Thailand, better quality rice,
they use only 350 kilograms of liters of per kilogram per rice. But after 18 years, condition is same. So they get more subsidies now, because at that time I can remember fertilizer was not given. Now the fertilizer also given. After when I delivered the lecture, he was in the as usual. He was in the audience. I got a long email next day from him, analyzing my speech, and in addition, he had entered the note with the quoting Omar Khayyam. He said, "Yeah, Omar Khayyam. I just repeat that. Myself, when young, did eagerly frequent doctor and saint, and heard great argument about it and about." But every more came out by the same door as in I went. So what he meant was, as Sri Lankans, we talk a lot but no action. You actually, I'm sorry to tell you, he was at that time, not now, he was very critical about ISL. Because ISL, once a week we have something, talk, but nothing happens. Not only ISL, everywhere. So the Sri Lanka, only talking and no action. Today, but I am going to tell you a story. With less talk, yeah, we did some work. It's a unique business model we developed. In 1977, some of my batchmates are here. When we joined the electricity board, we were very keen to go to Laksapana. So I was sent to Laksapana for a few months. Then I was transferred to Ukula Power Plant. Ukula Power Plant was brand new at that time. Ranjit will remember. After about 2 weeks, I got a transfer from CB, general manager, transferring me to transfer workshop at Kolona. That time the transfer workshop was considered the Siberia of CB, because Channamara Singh, who was there as electrical engineer, was on punishment transfer. So I made some inquiries. I found that GM at that time was Mr. Phillips, very nice gentleman. He was very friendly with Channa. So I thought no point telling Phillips, because he will never allow go against Channa. So I reported back. I reported to transfer workshop. Channa was there. After about 2-3 days, I found easy to work with Channa. Channa had one vision. He wanted to manufacture transformers in Sri Lanka. The reason was, in the transfer workshop, there were about 38 makes of transformers, and repairing was impossible. So he was very keen on manufacturing transformers. So from day one, I helped him. So we, after a lot of struggle, we prepared a proposal, which was unique at that time. I think that can be considered the first private-public partnership in Sri Lanka. We, after tender procedure, we selected a company in Scotland, one along of Scotland. That time they were very large transformer manufacturer. They were to invest 5 million in our venture and CEB 8 million. With the greatest difficulty, we managed to get 8 million. CEB were very reluctant. So the start of our LTL was like that. Then, of course, we had to get the approvals. For a short period, Mr. Gandhi Dhanayake was the power minister. When I met him at a dinner, since I knew him, I said, "Sir, we want to do something like that." He said, "UD, you take it as approved. You get the paperwork done through the secretaries." At that time, I think the secretary was Mr. James Landroll. Thereafter, Professor K.K.Y.W. Pereira came in. And actually, Professor K.K.Y.W. Pereira played a major role in getting these things, necessary cabinet approvals. I'm very happy that Professor Pereira is here. So after initial manpower to transform a plant was seconded from CEB, mostly even I was seconded from CEB. So all of us were, then some of us were trained in Bonalong, Scotland. I also was trained as a design engineer for 6 months. Bonalong at that time was a very large factory, very interesting place. They, I can remember now still, there were three canteens. One canteen for the directors, second one for the below managers, third one for the workers. As a trainee, I had the privilege of going to any canteen. So depending on the type of food, I used to use the canteen. But I had the most enjoyable time in the workers' canteen. So at that time, this Iron Lady, Mrs. Thatcher, was the Prime Minister of UK. And Scottish are generally left-oriented people. So they were dead against this Iron Lady. Daily, they criticize Iron Lady. These people who were seconded from CEB couldn't cope up with the private sector work. They opted to return to CEB, back to CEB. Chanda also was to be appointed as a general manager soon, so he also went back. So for some time I was the company secretary, design engineer, production manager, all that. Then 1988, Professor Perra, I was very young, Professor Perra appointed me as the CEO, General Manager of LTL Holdings Limited. I think Professor Perra took the decision. I think he didn't know me much, but he took a risk, I think. Maybe. Then immediately I thought this transformer design must be changed, because at that time the transformer was this conservator type, where once a month you had to go and do the filtering. So I decided to change it to the seal type, maintenance free. So in addition to that, we thought only way of surviving this LTL is to diversify our manufacturing initially. So the transform plant was set up in 1982. Then I mentioned earlier that we changed the design. The first batch, when we make it sealed transformers, it was a failure. First batch was a failure. It was when you centered the field, when you were energizing, it was failing. I can remember one incident. That time the minister was Mr. Chandra Bandara. In his electorate, he was to inaugurate a RE scheme. So he went and switched on our transformer. Transformer blasted with a big bang. Then all the guests, including chief guests, had been running for their dear lives, because that time the bombs were going in both north and south. But however, we made all our efforts. Mr. Vijaypal is in the audience. He was the design engineer. I appointed him as the design engineer. So he managed to correct that situation. I'm very glad that you are here. We went in for, there was no proper galvanizing in that time in Sri Lanka. Nobody was doing galvanizing. Because Sri Lanka needs galvanizing, our humidity is very high. You can't keep any steel item outside without galvanizing. So we started the plant in 1991, mainly to support the rural electrification at that time. Then we started steel fabrication in 1996. We started manufacturing the towers. All the transmission towers now you see in this in Sri Lanka, all over the island, I think it's about 80% manufactured by us. Then one interesting bit about the transformers is when we started the plant, only 14% of the Sri Lankans, or only 275,000 households, had electricity. In 2008, country achieved 100% electrification. For that purpose, we have supplied over 50,000 transformers. So we played a major role in electrifying this country. That is one achievement of the transformer plant. Now, of course, we export 60% of our production. Only 40% is for Sri Lankan market. And the plant is now almost 100% automated. Galvanizing, then we ran the full capacity was utilized in by 2000. We set up the galvanizing plant in 2000. Then from day one, after I took over LTL, my ambition was wanted to export somehow our transformers. In 2003, we managed to export our transformers for the first time. that was for Palestine under a NORAD aid, but within 3 weeks all those tanks were blasted by Israelis. Then we kept on adding plans. Then we were very keen on entering the Indian market. Though Indian market is huge, no one can enter in the market. That's so much protected. Even if the government allows, bureaucracy will not allow you to go in. So we thought the best way was to acquire a plant there. So we acquired a plant, a switchgear plant, 100% owned by us. That we are catering for the Middle East market from there. Then this year we hope to go in for solar PV manufacture, because thanks to Trump, this tariff, because of tariff, China can't compete in US market. So we thought it's the best time for us to get into this solar PV manufacture. So we are hoping to start solar PV manufacture this year, mainly for export, because there are no local market as such here. Then in so manufacturing our dealer plant like this, then in this is our transform plant. This outside is just like how we started, but inside we have changed a lot. Then this is our galvanizing plant at Sabhavaskand. Then steel fabrication, this is semi-automated, where we do towers. This is our market for transformers. We transport all over the world except US and South America, but it's mainly Middle East, and Jordan is our main market. This is our Asiatic factory in India. It's close to Delhi. We have about 400 people working there, all Indians. We don't have any Sri Lankans, just Indian is managing it, because India is difficult for Sri Lankans to manage. Then we got into power generation. That also was interesting. In 1997, as usual, there was a power crisis in the CEB, because they are not implementing the long-term generation plan. Even today is that. Then government at that time decided that they will buy power only on IPP basis. The CEB had already received a proposal from a foreign company to set up a power plant in Sabhavaskand. That time the CEB chairman was Dr. Leslie Herath, one of the best chairmans ever we had in the electricity board. He invited us to give a proposal. He knew that we have never done a power plant, but he said, you can do it. So I got together with our engineers, that very young team, we prepared a proposal. We gave a proposal to CEB and the ministry. That was about 50% cheaper than that foreign proposal. So all the at that time the minister was General Anuradha. He got cabinet approval, though the president at that time was not very happy about it. General Anuradha forced to give cabinet approval to us. But there was one hitch. We had to get a BOI approval. At that time, BOI was headed by a young, supposed to be a whiz kid. This whiz kid didn't want to approve the project, because I don't know for what reason. So it reminded us a story. Now hell is supposed to have separate pits for accommodating the different people from the world. And every pit had an anti-climbing device, except the Sri Lanka. Why? The Sri Lanka himself will bring you down. So this biscuit remembered that story to us. But later on he was pressurized to give the approval. But he had given the approval thinking that these people will really mess this up. So however we started, we completed a nice power plant within 7 months, and it was the cheapest at that time. We just 15 years we operated very successfully. Then of course we switched on to, then we did an emergency power plant in 2001 just to help CEB. But now we have taken a decision, we will never vote for emergency power plants. That's a crime. because all of us are paying for the better move of power cuts than giving having emergency power plant, because they are not implementing the long term power plants and go for emergency because very very expensive, and I think personally they benefit more than the country. Then we went for mini hydro. This is the second mini hydro plant set up in Sri Lanka. Very good, still operating very successfully. Then we went in for 100 megawatt tender at Putlam. That was the cheapest power plant available in the system. We had contract was over about 3 years back. For a strange reason, they never extended our contract and extended all the other contracts except the Lakhdanim one. So we were forced to sell our machines to Turkey. Now the Turkey bought our machines. I don't know how this government is supposed to get a barge from Turkey. I don't know that barge is our machines are included in that. Luckily, I think it's not going on. It's not working. I think it's not allowed or something like that. So then another interesting project in 2009, we completed the thermal power plant in Kerolapitiya. Kerolapitiya also, when Mahinda Rajapaksa government came into power in 2005, they realized by 2008, if they don't have 200 megawatt in the system, they'll have power cuts. So they were helpless, and they knew that with the tender procedure, they'll never be able to set up a power plant in a short period. So they analyzed the situation, and they found that we were the most reliable party, though we had never done a combined cycle power plant. But they thought that somehow we will do it. Then the secretary at that time, very dynamic person, he managed to get the cabinet approval. We getting the proposal was also very difficult, because when we asked the reputed suppliers, machine suppliers, to give us a quote, they were very reluctant because they were taking us as a joke. Luckily, General Electric had a manager in South Asia. His father had worked in Sri Lanka for some time. Because of that connection, he had thought that he will just listen to us. Then I called him and he invited us to come to India. So we went to India. Then he knew that we will do this. He gave a very nice proposal. CB wanted a combined cycle plant operating on diesel, but we gave a proposal operating in heavy fuel, which was much cheaper. I think CB saves about 10 billion rupees per year because it's operating on heavy oil. Again, this time there was another whiz kid. This time, of course, an old whiz kid. He was writing weekly to paper articles saying that that gas turbines will never work with heavy fuel. We replied him once, but he never listened. He continued to write, so we ignored him later on. But after the power plant was set up and in operation, he was silent and I called him and invited, but he said he has no time. CB wanted a EPC type proposal. That means that we will do the construction and they'll pay it for us. When our power ministry took the proposal to the finance ministry, Dr. Jayasundara said they don't have money. These will have to go for a IPP. That IPP means we'll have to invest and we have to do everything and sign a power purchase agreement. I must tell you there when we gave the proposal, it was not our proposal alone. We had there was a price proposal from China. There was a proposal from Mitsubishi. The ministry appointed a 13-member technical evaluation committee to evaluate this. After the evaluation, only we were awarded. But after we were asked to give a IPP proposal, we had to arrange some innovative funding. we had to use four different export credit agencies. You can imagine dealing with export credit agencies is not easy. It was a very difficult task. They had to get the local money. We use EPF, NSB, ETF, and other investors for LTL and LEPO. At that time, I can remember Seema honored our CFO, an engineer by profession, as CFO of the year for this innovative funding. So then we kept on adding power plants like this, Kerala bit here, then wind, we went in for wind, then first power plant in Bangladesh was set up in 2015, then again mini hydros like that, mini hydros, then second power plant in Bangladesh, it will be I think commissioned next week, then we are doing a 10 megawatt in Nepal now. Then for CEB, we constructed a 20 megawatt power plant in Chunakam. Then now at the we are constructing a small solar plant as well. This is the paper that the old kid was writing. Then this is our first power plant in Sapugaskanda. It was a beautiful power plant. Then Velluloy power plant. Then this is the 100 megawatt thermal plant at Putlam, which is now dismantled. Then 300 megawatt thermal power plant at Kerolapitiya, still in operation full time. Then we these are wind plants. Then these are first power plant in Bangladesh in operation now. This will be commissioned next week, 115 megawatt thermal power plant in Bangladesh. Then the diversification was construction. We constructed the first CB substation in 1997. That was the Ampara substation. Then in 2001, we constructed the first transmission line. That is in again in Ampara. Then 2000, like that we were doing a lot of projects in Sri Lanka. Then 2010, we did our first project in Uganda. 2011. First transmission project in Kenya, then first 100 megawatt plant we constructed for a private sector party in 2011, then first transmission line project in Tanzania, then 100 again for a Bangladeshi owner, we constructed a power plant, then Maldives we did a 10 megawatt, then 2008 we did another 100 megawatt to Bangladesh, like that we did several projects with this construction. This is the first substation in Ampara, still is in operation. This is our first substation, transmission line project in Ampara. This is our first 100 megawatt power plant in Bangladesh. This is 160 megawatt under construction in Bangladesh. Now I'll come to our final results. Total turnover is about $75 billion, and this income 70% now 70% come from abroad, only 30% from Sri Lanka, 70% from outside. We made a profit of $16 billion last year. Then our profit is about $16 billion. We have 7 offices globally. It is a global company now. We have more foreign employees than Sri Lankan employees at the moment. We have more power plants overseas than in Sri Lanka. CEV invested $97 billion in this company. You can imagine how much we have paid. We have paid $15 billion dividends. But it's a very good investment for CEV. Last 3 years we have paid $8 billion taxes to the government. So you will realize this is a very successful operation. Then I will. It will be more useful if I explain to you because there's a big, large, young crowd here. How we did it? It will be very interesting for you all. So before I explain that, I'll have to go to little history. In Sri Lanka. we had an entrepreneur culture just before the independence and after independence also. We had entrepreneurs like Vijay Vardhana, Soisas, Amara Suryas, Dimels, Jnanams, Hydramanis, Javadis, Akbars, Navaloka Mudalali, Dasa Mudalali, Melbourne Mudalali, etc. So we had an entrepreneur culture. Then the children of this rich entrepreneurs at that time, including my friend Ray, was sent for their education in UK. UK at that time, it was just after the war, they were promoting this left-oriented ideas, they were on socialist thinking. London School of Economics, supposed to be one of the top economic institutions in the world. They were their professors, they were promoting socialist economic theories. So our people, the children of rich these entrepreneurs who were there, so they also adopted these ideas. And they came back to Sri Lanka with those ideas. Ray was parallel to them, but Ray was not interested in politics, so he just went for his to manage his estates. At the same time, Ray used to tell me one of his contemporaries at Cambridge was Lee Kuan Yew. Even Lee Kuan Yew at that time was a socialist. When he returned to Singapore, he realized that it's not going to work. And there were some other batchmates also returned with Lee Kuan Yew to Singapore, but they were not allowing Lee Kuan Yew to change. So Lee Kuan Yew had to, as his usual style, he had to get rid of them. Sri Lanka, they returned. Our people, actually they were very honorable, intelligent people. Our people, especially the working class, they like these ideas. Even in Sri Lanka today, majority always promote leftist ideas. Actually, because of this originally thinking, still our society is more left-oriented thinking. If you talk about privatism, they really object. Majority is for socialism. Then 1953, as a young finance minister, J.R. Jayawardena, he wanted to introduce reforms. He wanted to get rid of the subsidies even during the war. In his budget, he proposed the all subsidies to be withdrawn. Then the leftists who had returned from London organized a hartal, and they brought down the government. JR couldn't implement these reforms. If he was allowed to implement the reforms, Sri Lanka would have been a different country today. Unfortunately, he couldn't do the reforms. Actually, so far, I think that nobody really, 77 he tried, but still couldn't do it properly. Then, I don't know about a lot of people about thinking about it, but 56 language policy also, and language policy together with the nationalization destroyed the entrepreneurship. I know Ray lost about 1,000 acres of very productive coconut land. He said he didn't mind donating that to the government, but the problem was they destroyed all that. I finally he was left with only 50 acres, and it was well managed. Of course, because of this reason, now there are no entrepreneurs in Sri Lanka. Very rarely you get an entrepreneur. All are wheeler dealers. We call them businessmen, but they are wheeler dealers, nothing else. So we have to study this little history before developing our own company culture. In 1998, I was trying to set up a manufacturing plant in Malaysia. Malaysia has the Bumiputra policy. Whatever the company you set up, Bumiputra must head your company. Chairman must be a Bumiputra. So we also hired a Bumiputra. We paid a royalty. He didn't do anything. So we just paid royalty to him. So the Bumiputra culture, even Mahathir, it was a very unfair thing, but even Mahathir didn't want to change it. Because he realized that the Malays are lazy and they can't do any, they are not productive. Chinese are very productive and they had the entrepreneurship. And the Tamils there, they had the brains. So we understood, we thought even Sri Lanka may be same. I will not mention go into detail in Sri Lanka. But we used ethnic diversity as a strength in our campaign. We use all different ethnic groups in our campaign. Then we promote entrepreneurship. We promote productivity. We also, for the young engineers especially, we try to eliminate fear of failure. This is a problem. You can't be an entrepreneur if you have fear of failure. If you are scared of going bankrupt, don't be an entrepreneur. So we develop that culture, especially among the younger crowd. Now they are matured. Now they have no fear of failure. Then constantly looking for opportunities and getting the timing right is very important. In cricket, when you play a shot, it's not the how fast you hit the shot, but it's the timing. So timing is very important. So last 4.5 years we decided Sri Lanka, nothing will happen. We concentrated fully our Bangladesh work, Uganda work, Tanzania work. So as we thought correctly, nothing has happened in Sri Lanka last 4.5 years. That's the truth. Then because of this innovation, I'll just tell you, I'll try to not take it in detail, I'll just show you certain things that we did, our innovative engineers did. When we setting up the Putlam power plant, the engines were very heavy. So we could transport using the road network. So we were forced to transport sea transport. But sea transport close to our site, we had to construct a harbor to bring those engines from the ship, from the barge. To construct the harbor, but we knew that it's going to be a difficult thing. So that area, the fishermen had, they were doing marjal fishing. So we compensated the fishermen for their 6 months income. They were very happy because we paid them beforehand. So they were just idling after for 6 months. So when we started constructing a small harbor, we had to have a 3 meter depth to bring our barge. So we constructed successfully, but this is a, then halfway we found that sand piling up in one end. So we kept on using a sand pump, continuously pumping sand to the other side. So like till the engines came, we had to do this. And finally, we constructed this successfully, the engines were brought there, then we took it to the road and transported. That was I can still remember, Ray visited this site and he was very, very happy. Then this Kerala PTR engine transport, also same story, Kun transport along the road. So we bought it along the, from the harbour in the sea, then Kalani River. Then we used the Hamilton Canal. We dredged Hamilton Canal for about 1 kilometer to bring the engines along the Hamilton Canal. This Hamilton Canal. Then there was another interesting thing. Kerala PTA didn't have fresh water. So we had to get sea water. Even for say boilers, we had to do desalination and get fresh water. For that, we had to get sea water. We had to lay a pipeline about 2 kilometers into the sea. So we got quotations from several people from abroad. Their proposal was to bring a special ship to lay the pipeline. That was beyond our budget. We were helpless. So our engineers thought, we'll try our own methods. So they design something, the pipe on that, they put some concrete blocks like that. Then it took about 2 days, then filled water, sealed in, and it sunk. So still is there, so without any problem. So by doing the certain things that our engineers had the innovative culture. Then other thing we practiced was less talk and more work. Professor Ferrer knows about this. We have only about 3 board meetings per year. And sometimes Professor Ferrer says two meetings in year during his time. This is not I am not what I am saying. Professor MOAD Soisa, former vice chancellor Peradeniya University, says out of the 225 MPs in our parliament, 94 MPs are with no O level, 25 graduates, but all of us know they are very good orators. See the daily every night they are TV debates. They are very good orators, but talk, but what has happened? So LTL, we were very keen not to have meetings, minimize the meetings and do work. Even management meetings, we restrict to a minimum. We practice a thing called nominification. This is a Japanese thing. The Japanese word for nomi is drinking. So we, once a month, we have a session like this. So this is the best way to get their ideas, especially when they are drunk. So always we get, so we have once a month we have these sessions. Then the other thing is the employee share ownership. Our partner was, initially it was born along, then later on ABB bought over. ABB decided to leave, they want to leave this market. They were trying to sell it outside, but our senior employees got together and gave them offer. We arranged a loan from NDB and we bought over the shares. So now 37% of the shares of LTL owned by the employees. I think this is the only company, maybe large percentage of shares owned by employees. I think UK, of course, we have John Lewis, Waitrose, owned by employees. Because of this factor, we minimize political interference. All the politicians always we say employees are the owners here, you have to be careful. So they are always careful. Especially the higher management is highly motivated, because our management, most of, not only the manager, even the other employees, they are all shareholders. So they are not worried about the annual increments or the bonus or anything like that. They are worried about the company profit. Because we know if you get the company with the profit right, their income go on. And there is no corruption inside the organization, because they get enough dividends. Then I'll try to explain to you engineering graduates as entrepreneurs. We had to do that. Now, if you take a definition of engineering, engineering is imagining things. Engineering is making things. Engineering is a creative process. Engineering is helping people. So who are the entrepreneurs? Same. Entrepreneurs also imagining things. They have to imagine things, making things. We have to be creative and you have to help people. So if you are an engineer, you are naturally entrepreneur. Then take this, out of 7 billion people in the world, there are 400 entrepreneurs, not bad, and only 430 million unemployed, and only 400 entrepreneurs. So these 400 entrepreneurs keep the 7 billion people going. Then if you take the latest Forbes list, 34 companies are headed by engineers. So engineers should have, the engineers are natural entrepreneurs. But unfortunately, Sri Lanka is not so. Why is that? We realize our education system do not promote innovation at all. We get our children used to tuition culture, that is memory based system. We were the last batch to do the A-level exam, do practicals in the A-level exam. That time you can remember Mrs. Bandaranaike's government, she said within a few years she will introduce practicals again, because at that time the urban students had a benefit, because rural rural school didn't have proper laboratories. The government promised within a few years they will switch back to the practicals, because practicals is very important. But after 40 years it's same, now it's worse. If you are children, you realize for an A-level student you are not allowed to take a simple calculator for the exam. But this government is talking about giving tablets to them. at least first give a calculator to them. So when we were recruiting from the universities also, we had to be careful. So we were looking for these factors. Professor Lucas was our agent there. He was monitoring people, and he's always recommend people to for LTL. I'm very glad to say over 500 engineers had gone through LTL. Some of them have ended up as very good entrepreneurs. They have left us, but they have got our training, LTL training. Most of the people used LTL as a second university. Now we have not only produced entrepreneurs. Now I am very glad we have produced a professor also from LTL. Then of course this is another factor is affecting LTL. Now LTL employees, we do not just expect integrity from our staff, but we ensure it also. So because of that, they are in trouble. Recently, this Pakistan Prime Minister Imran Khan, delivering a lecture at Oxford Union, he tried to explain this. He said there are two types of people. First one, they corrupt the system to make money. If you take their percent, it is minimal, not even 1%. Even in Sri Lanka, it is 0.1%. But Lee Kuan Yew did was to get rid of this one. But what we are trying to do here is get rid of two. It's impossible because all of us are corrupt. Because we have got corrupted by the system. I'll give another example. There was a Colombo suburb mayor. To get your building plan approved, if you approach one of his agents, if it is a large project, he will come to your place. You don't have to go there either. So he take your drawings, agree on a fee. After a few weeks, you get the approval. So it's a very efficient system. Because in Melbourne, we are trying to do a project, and took about 7 months to get the building plan approved. Of course, you can't write there. So this corruption really affects us. I'll just give a classic example. The Kerala PTA power plant, which is before the Supreme Court. I'll not go into detail because it's under the Supreme Court. From the beginning, the authorities were trying to eliminate Lakdanavi because they knew that Lakdanavi will be the cheapest. They tried the two Onilock methods, that is, you give the technical proposal and the financial proposal later. In the technical proposal, there was a 13-member technical evaluation committee. They recommended all bids to be open. But when you enter the cabinet-appointed tender board, they decided, picked up some point from the TEC, said that all should be disqualified except that one Korean thing. So they decided to open only the Korean bid. Unfortunately, that Korean bid didn't have a financial proposal. So they had to give it up. But later on, I found out their price was 22 rupees. Then they were forced to open this all the tenders. We were the lowest. Then the TEC, actually, it was a very easy job for TEC. Experience wise, we had done a more complicated power plant. Everybody knew about our balance sheet. We had the strength, but technical evaluation, whenever they go with a solution, cabinet appointed tender board always reject that for whatever the reason. Took about 1.5 years to convince the cabinet CNC. They finally approved it. Then very interesting thing happened. As per the RFP of this tender, IPP. They were to follow 1998 guidelines for private sector financial projects. So they followed this procedure very faithfully. When it came to the price opening, they realized that Lakdanavi is the cheapest. Then they switched on to the other procurement guidelines, which is not for IPP, just normal procurement. This is something like now you start playing a cricket match under cricket rules, and when you realize the opponent is winning, you change the rules to baseball. Same thing happened here. So, anyway, this is before the Supreme Court. So really corruption had affected us. Now I'll just try to explain to you briefly way forward for Sri Lanka with all these problems. I'll just compare few days back the FDI inflows to the different countries. Now this is the thing for 2018. Now 2018, this is before the bomb blast. Sri Lanka received $1.6 billion in FDI and 2.3 million tourists visited. Vietnam, $35.4 billion FDI, 16.5 million tourist arrivals. Cambodia, $3.1 billion FDI, 6.2 million tourist arrivals. China, of course, you can't compare, $139 million FDI, 140 tourist arrivals. Singapore, $78 million in FDI, 18.5 million tourist arrivals. Thailand, 10.4 FDI, 38.27 million tourist arrivals. Now compare these countries. Sri Lanka, we have 5-star democracy. Not only the 5-star democracy, now we have the Yahapalani. But none of these countries have Yahapalani or no democracy. Vietnam, no democracy. Cambodia, no democracy. China, no democracy. Singapore also, not much. Thailand, military government. So the tourists prefer these countries. I don't know whether they don't like this democratic Yahapalani countries. Even the investors. So what they are looking is stability of the country, political stability. They are not worried about the Yahapalani or whatever it is. And they want a judiciary system, transparent, especially the commercial sector. Our commercial courts, there are 5,000 cases outstanding. How can an investor come here? And if, anyway, any businessman will have a dispute, you have to go to courts. So if you can't get a solution from courts, how can you come here and invest? So this is a problem we have. Then the other most important thing is now these days the election is coming around, so we will get manifestos. Actually, what they used to do is auctioning the non-available resources. So always they give the expenditure side, but nobody gives the income. Actually, all of us should get together when they come next time. We'll ask show us your income. Now one man already is promising the government salaries will be increased by up to 50,000. So we'll ask how to get the income. So whenever this time when they come with manifestos, you ask for income statement also, budget. So expenditure you can say, we are going to spend so much, so they must give us the income source. Then our race vision. Now we got together with Ray and we demonstrated that dendro power is feasible using Guinnesseria wood, and we demonstrated one diesel engine running on Guinnesseria syngas. But a lot of people misunderstand. Ray's idea was not to replace coal power plants immediately. He was not worried about that, but he had a further, because during his time the climate change was not very visible, but he foresaw that. We are now, if you take the hydro generation, though we had the rainfall figures almost same, our hydro generation had decreased. The reason, we don't have enough water in the rivers. We don't have enough water in the reserves because the river basins should have the trees. Trees only will retain, because what is the source of water to Sri Lanka? What is the water resource is only rain. There's nothing else. So once you get the rain, we must retain it. Best way to retain it? Have trees. And further, Ray was worried about this soil erosion. So to stop this, best solution is not a rocket science. River basins, grow trees. But if there are forest see the river flow down this somewhere around Mahavali, somewhere around Gampola. If there's a forest, grow more forest trees in the forest, but other areas you grow trees, see or things like Girisi area, and you have a plan, you prune it and use it for dendropower. So you generate power, you can give a subsidized price to these farmers, so that because we benefit, these benefit is two way. One is we are going to retain water, we stop soil erosion, and we generate our own energy. We send them so we must give whoever comes the next time, we must say you priority to this, because we have 2000 kilometers of rivers and over 1000 kilometers of small rivers. Of course the urban areas we can't do anything, but certain areas we must go for tree planting. You can get the farmers to do that. We supply good quality timber, so that and advise them technically what to do, and the dendropower plant can buy those power. We what that is agroforestry. We must go for agroforestry, otherwise within 10 years we will not have drinking water in Sri Lanka, because water retention now, see now these days heavy rain, but see in about 2 weeks time there will be a dry period and we will run short of water. So this is the only solution. More than anything else, we must concentrate on this river basins, grow more trees on the river basins. Then I know a lot of people will not agree with me. This government did three good things: Indian Free Trade Agreement, Singapore Trade Agreement, Arvakkalu Sanitary Field. Indian Free Trade Zone, lot of people including ISL members protested, but that is your mental mental island mentality. Because a company, you will understand our market is 20 million people, we have to go out. All these companies must be forced to go out, see what however it is, how mass holding Brandix is doing and how LTL is doing. We have to go out. So this Indian Free Trade Agreement, actually if they implemented this, we had the advantage. We could have exported our transfers to the Indian plant, they could have combined with their switchgear and given as a package. Singapore, similarly, Singapore, if you get now, this manufacturing is nowadays is not a total heavy product, it's just a small part in the supply chain. If we had the free trade in Singapore, we could have just supplied a small part to Singapore. That's a big thing, it's a huge thing. Say that now, say the Apple phone is not manufactured in the US, it's manufactured in about 10 countries. They do only the marketing. So we must, that of course there is a temporary set down because the tariff things, but it will get settled. But we must get into a supply chain, otherwise we are sunk. Then everybody talks about the state-owned enterprises. I was telling some people before the lecture also, solution is simple. Now things like electricity board, water board and all, they are controlled by the treasury because of just one bill, 1971 Finance Act. There's under the certain clause, Secretary Finance can give the approval for this organization to be free. At the moment, if you take any corporation, who is the chairman? Chairman is the minister. Who is the CEO? Secretary to the ministry. Who is the CFO? Treasury. So how can the organization run in this country? Give them independence. We have very good managers, all these places. I know personally. They will do a very good job. Give them independency and release them from this Finance Act. They will do a very good job. That's very easy to do. I think it's just one letter from the Secretary of Finance releasing these people. As long as these people are under the Treasury and the Minister being the Chairman and the Secretary being the CEO, you will never come out. So Singapore Tamasek was something like that. LTL is also something like that. So my message to you, follow this. Thank you.
Thank you to the Professor Jayawardena for that.
I'm not Professor.
Sorry, I'm your pardon, Engineer Jayawardena. That is, I think, an honor that you deserve after that ovation, sir. So I don't think you'd mind me giving you that honor this evening. May I call upon the President of the Institution of Engineers of Sri Lanka to hand over this memento of appreciation to our speaker this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving a warm round of applause to our speaker this evening for that absolutely brilliant address. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, let me now call upon Engineer H.C.J. Tilakaratna, the Chairman of the Agricultural and Plantation Engineering Sectional Committee of the Institution of Engineers of Sri Lanka, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Good evening. Mr. President and Engineer Professor Palivartha, our guest lecturer, Engineer Yudhi Jayawardena, all our past presidents, fellow members, and all the faculty members from Ray Vijayawardena, our late Dr. Ray Vijayawardena, and Engineer Professor Malik Ransinger. It is my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. I, on behalf of Agriculture and Plantation Sectional Committee and the Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka, extend a very heartiest vote of thanks to our great speaker, Engineer Yudhi Jayawardena, for gracing your important work and sharing with your findings and opinions today. As you mentioned, sir, it is a timely need of our engineers to get the role of inventions to make the life easier, because I have seen that it is the engineers to support the public. Really late, Dr. Ray Vijayawardena is about 64 years back. He done his part. Unfortunately, we couldn't continue it. Still, we are looking for imported solutions. As you very correctly said, sir, our engineers are away from the research and they just engaging in the job, getting a monthly remuneration packages in private sector and government sector nowadays. It's very sad to say, sir, very nearly I heard that when the government recruited custom officers very recently, 35% of them are engineers, that just pass out graduates. It's a very sad story. So that I have to thank very much you, sir, your timely required lecture on transferring the local engineers into global entrepreneurs. Further, on behalf of Agricultural Sectional Committee and the Institute of Engineers Sri Lanka, I convey our sincere thanks to the family members of late Dr. Ray Vijayawardena for participating and gracing this event today evening. Finally, on behalf of the Agricultural and Plantation Sectional Committee, I must thank to our ISL President, Professor Engineer Professor Palivartha, and Professor Engineer Professor Malik Ranasinghe from the Ray Vijayawardena Charitable Trust, and our Executive Secretary, and all our participants today to be with us to make this event a great success. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Engineer Thilakaratna. That brings us to the conclusion of this evening's proceedings, ladies and gentlemen, but not before I place before you our humble gratitude towards the following persons who, without whose contribution this event would not have been possible. First and foremost, of course, the speaker, the person who delivered the 2019 Ray Vijayawardhana Memorial Lecture, none other than Engineer U.D. Jayawardhana. Let us give him a resounding round of applause once again. Thank you, sir, for that well-researched presentation to the audience and for placing before us the groundbreaking achievements that you have achieved through your company in the field of power generation in Sri Lanka, which you have taken overseas and through that brought so much pride to this nation and also very valuable foreign revenue. It is interesting that you mentioned that your first meeting with Dr. Ray Vijayawardhana, during that first meeting, you were able to taste your first single malt Scotch whisky. And thereafter, you mentioned that your company, you have only a few board meetings, two board meetings a year, and you make sure that there is one meeting in which you ensure that that elixir of knowledge is used so that more knowledge and more ideas will flow. So, what you got from, I think the best thing you got from the late Dr. Ray Vijayawardhana was the fact that there are certain liquids that facilitate new ideas. And I think that is something that we can also take back with us. But thank you, sir, for what you have achieved and for sharing that so unstintingly with us, this audience, and those of us who have been involved in the organization of this event. Despite the various challenges of bureaucracy and corruption and even the security situation in the country at the time, having to deal with old and young whiz kids, as he called them, I believe every single one of you has been truly blessed by this opportunity that you've been given, and let me congratulate you for taking time off your busy schedules to be here this evening. I know with all our commitments, it is difficult to carve out some time to be here, but as Benjamin Franklin once said, an investment in knowledge pays the best dividend. So I believe you will take back with you valuable knowledge which you yourselves can now apply to your various fields of expertise. I would also like to thank, of course, the Institution of Engineers of Sri Lanka on behalf of the Trust. Without the institution, this event would not be possible, so we are most grateful to the institution. We would also like to thank the media sponsors. The print media sponsors are Daily FT, Daily Mirror, The Sunday Times, Lankadipa and Hai. Of course, Art TV always partners with the Trust in covering this event, and we are most grateful to Art TV for their continued patronage. And of course, Mr. Hemin the Jayavira for so willingly assisting the Trust in the organization of this event. Ladies and gentlemen, that brings us to the conclusion of the 2019 Dr. Ray Vijayawardhana Memorial Lecture. Thank you once again for gracing this event. And let me take this opportunity to wish you a very pleasant evening. Good night.